Emission Controls, this is a companion video to my high school auto mechanics level 2 class where we talk about emission controls. I know, it's a PowerPoint. How weird. I don't usually use PowerPoints, but this is a leftover PowerPoint from the bad old days, and I'm using it. I actually ditched a bunch of pictures out of it, but never you mind. By now, I've already dealt with the level 1s in whatever unit they're going on, probably cooling system, don't know, don't care. I'm going to focus on you guys, and it's emission controls today. So, if I can get my PowerPoint to point the power, apparently we need to see the title twice, we're just going to look at some parts of the gases and how we're dealing with the gases. I will worry about the emission control devices in the theory part in class. I'm not going to cover it here because about this point you've worked your way through the worksheets and then you're kind of confused by the gases. So these are pictures of places. Like, you can Google this stuff, and the world has done a lot to try and make air quality a lot better. I remember being a kid in Los Angeles and my eyes just burning from the stuff in the air, and even not too long ago, staring at the sun in Los Angeles, and the sun hadn't set yet, and it was a lovely orange hue. New York can be pretty interesting. There's parts of Windsor, Ontario, where you just want to put a towel over your head and wait until you get past it. Beijing. I've never been to Beijing, but if you can stare at the sun and it doesn't hurt, you probably have an air quality problem. But apparently things have been improving in a lot of different parts of the world. I know in Vancouver, on a bad day on the highway, you can't see the mountains because the ground level ozone has made it pretty nasty. And I had to stay inside because the pollution in the air in Vancouver would just hurt my lungs. And there's something different about the stuff in the air in Vancouver than here in the Okanagan. When we've had the big forest fires and it's like smoke in the air up here, I can still breathe. But in Vancouver, it just hurt too much. So, anyways, what we want to have is perfect combustion. We talk fuel systems in level 1, and we know about trying to get perfect combustion in a stoichiometric mixture. And we know that fuel is going to be hydrocarbons and oxygen. And then in a magical, mystical world of happiness and sunshine and unicorns, these recombine to be hydrogen monoxide and carbon dioxide, H2O and CO2. Water, good for you. CO2, trees love it. Kind of cool. But that's not necessarily reality because we're not actually burning strictly hydrocarbons and oxygen. Air is, in our atmosphere, 79% nitrogen, 20% oxygen. You can't breathe pure oxygen from like the welding tanks. It will probably kill you. You need to have 79% nitrogen for your body to work. And then we've got 1% cow farts. Who knows? Whatever it is. And all of that stuff is going to combine to what's in our gasoline. The fuel that we burn, and this is out of date. Fuels are consisting of different materials. One of these has been axed by most gas companies. And so the gasoline has gasoline. It also has benzene, ethyl benzene, naphthalene, ethanol, methyl tert-butyl ether, although that has recently been axed. Most gas companies don't want to tell you what's in the gas. This is what I found from a company that did tell us what was in it. If you can't pronounce it, it's probably not good for you. Tertiary amyl methyl ether and ethyl tert-butyl ether, they all combine with everything that's in our earth. And who knows how that all combines? It's freaking magical. But we check on 4 basic pollutants or 4 basic emissions from the back of our vehicle. Hydrocarbons, which we fed the engine, should have been burnt. We get carbon monoxide. We wanted it to be CO2. It didn't get there. So CO, carbon monoxide, that's the silent killer. Unlike my chili cheese burrito enchilada platter after effect, that's a silent killer too. Silent but violent. And then we got NOx and particulates. Yay, you rolling coal brodozers. So here's our magical, mystical of fun. In the middle of stoichiometric, the perfect mix between rich and lean. It looks like I'm blocking lean. Let's unblock that. That's kind of weird. Okay, so rich, way too much fuel. Lean, not enough fuel. And so let's look at what's going on in here. If we look at just fuel, this is the line of what's happening with our hydrocarbons, the fuel itself, regardless of what chemical makeup it is, this is the fuel itself. And if we're running a stoichiometric 14.7 pounds of air to 1 pound of fuel, that's your perfect mix, it would make sense that hydrocarbons would be at their lowest. That's what they should be. And if we go richer and richer, yeah, some of that fuel is not going to get burnt because it's not the perfect mix. It's too much fuel. And some of that fuel is going to go right out the exhaust pipe and not even be burned. But let's go lean. If we go over to the lean world over here, hydrocarbons are starting to go up as we go lean. How can that be? Well, as you get leaner and leaner and leaner, you're going to reach a point where hydrocarbons, the mixture is too lean to even ignite. And so it goes right out the exhaust without even having been burnt at all. So too lean, they call it like a lean misfire, like it sparks, but it ain't burning nothing. It's like you're trying to light a forest fire with a match and no forest. It's not going to do the job. So if it's stoichiometric, hydrocarbons will be low. If it's too rich, it didn't burn because there's too much of it. If it's too lean, it didn't burn because there wasn't enough of it to burn. So you got raw right out the tailpipe. Now, carbon dioxide is what we want to have coming out the tailpipe. So theoretically, you could be huffing on the tailpipe. Don't huff on the tailpipe. Don't even breathe carbon dioxide. Let's be honest, that doesn't work. So carbon dioxide, perfect mix. It should be high. We want to see lots of carbon dioxide. Greenhouse gas killer, I know. Trees love it. But we want to see the CO2 really high. If we venture too rich or too lean, it's not the perfect mix. We're not going to maximize our CO2. And so we're going to have CO2 drop lower and lower and lower. We don't really look too much at how much CO2 is coming out the tailpipe. But we use it as an indicator to know what's going on, what's wrong with our vehicle. So we want it to be high. Now, oxygen, again, not a bad pollutant. If our vehicle puked out just oxygen, we could huff on the tailpipe like we've always imagined. But you can't because we don't really get much out of there. You get the wee bit of oxygen, and we just use it to kind of look at and get some clues as to what's going on with our vehicle. Let's say I put a sniffer up the tailpipe of the car and the hydrocarbons are huge. Oh my gosh, way too much hydrocarbons. Next thing I look at is, what's the oxygen doing? And here's what's going on with the oxygen. In theory, you take all the oxygen you need, you burn it with the fuel, and it's taken care of. So if it's pig rich, we took all the oxygen, burned it with the fuel, so it's all gone. We should have no extra oxygen coming out the tailpipe. So if it's rich and the oxygen is low, it's rich. If there's lots of hydrocarbons, but the oxygen is low, it's rich. Look on the other side, if it's rich, lots of hydrocarbons coming out, but the O2 is coming up. That's the air that didn't join the fuel because it lean misfired and didn't burn at all. So we put oxygen and hydrocarbons into the engine. It didn't burn. What's going to come out? Back to that chili cheese burrito enchilada platter. If your body doesn't process it, she's coming out. So we got the hydrocarbons are going up. If the oxygen's going up, none of that stuff got combined into combustion. So it was a lean misfire. You got a lean issue. If there's low oxygen, all that oxygen got used, it's just going to be rich. You got too much fuel. Kind of tells you which side of the graph you want to be on. Carbon monoxide is incomplete combustion. This is the stuff that kills you. It's heavier than air. So if you're running an engine in a confined space, that stuff starts to get higher and higher and then gets rid of the oxygen. And then you're trying to breathe this and then you die. Be very careful with this. Lots of stories of people I know who've been in vehicles and like in winter and just idling to keep warm, and the exhaust kind of floats into the vehicle through like rust holes or a leaky exhaust system, and the carbon monoxide fills up the vehicle and they die because of this. So you need to be careful. You can't smell it. You can't tell that it's there. It's a horrific way that it's just like, no, don't do it. So here's what's going on for the pollutant. Carbon monoxide is, it was on the way to being combusted. It was going to become CO2, but it didn't quite get there. So what happened with that is it's just pig rich. You get so much fuel, some of it got burnt, some of it didn't get burnt at all, and it's coming out as hydrocarbons, and some of it got kind of part way and then got lost because there's too much of it. It just, so your CO is really high and the hydrocarbons are high. That's a rich issue. Let's look over here at lean. Lean, the CO is really low because the fuel either burned or it did not burn. There's not going to be any in between. You either ate it or didn't eat it. There's no half anything here. So it's kind of a clue what's going on. I get a vehicle, check the emissions coming out of the exhaust pipe, high hydrocarbons, high carbon monoxide. That's too much fuel. Vehicle comes in, high hydrocarbons, low carbon monoxide, probably lean. Let's look at what oxygen's doing. Oxygen's high. Ah, that makes sense. And those are the basics pollutants of the fuel issue. But then if you want to reduce the hydrocarbons, things you can do to reduce the hydrocarbon emission is make that combustion hotter, like raise the compression ratio, change the cam timing so it really squeezes a lot of air-fuel mixture, or a really hot spark, or raise the engine operating temperature. Anything you can do to get more heat into the fuel will make it burn better, which is cool. But just like everything in life, there's a downside, and the downside is high temperature combustion causes oxides of nitrogen. So that the nitrogen that we had in the air kind of reacts, it kind of burns with the oxygen because the temperature is too hot. And that's the stuff that becomes low level, ground level ozone, that brown haze that you see on the horizon. And that's really not nice stuff at all. But you want to reduce hydrocarbons, you increase NOx. Interestingly, when you're getting into like stoichiometric and just a little bit lean to get some good fuel economy and reduce your hydrocarbons, that's where NOx goes through the roof. Anything you can do to bring the NOx down is going to bring the hydrocarbons up. So there's no free lunch. There's ways they change the refinement of how an engine runs, or different shaped combustion chambers, cam timing, and there's engineering that goes into the motor, and that's a good way to go. And then there's a bunch of add-ons that we put on the motor to help deal with this. And most of the pollution controls don't hurt you for power and can improve fuel economy. And one we use is an exhaust gas recirculation valve that helps bring the NOx down and improves fuel economy. But we'll talk more of that in class in the theory when we look at the actual components. I just wanted to show you the fuel and everything here. Hydrocarbons either burned beautifully, or there's too much of it and it didn't burn, or it didn't burn at all if it's too lean. I guess I should put my hands in here more like this. I'm too close. If there's carbon monoxide, it didn't finish burning, so it's too rich. If there's no carbon monoxide and there's high hydrocarbons, it's lean. It lean misfired, and oxygen helps you figure out what's going on there. And you can, we'll talk more about it in class. But these are the basic dynamics of those gases that are coming through. Good luck.